Hi all. In this tutorial, we'll look at the collateral management function in the bank and why in recent times this department has become one of the strategic departments for the bank. What are the regulations that came in this space after the 2007-2008 crisis, and how, in order for bank to survive and be of competitive advantage across its competitors, this department has to do a lot of activities for the bank. So in this tutorial, we'll start from the basics, where we'll say what is collateral. We'll cover why do we need collateral, what are the advantages and disadvantages of having collateral, what are the types of instruments that can be accepted as collateral. Then we will start looking at how this function is set up within the bank or within the enterprise. What are the key activities that are done within those within the bank for this function? Then we will talk about what are the collateral agreements and how they are set up. We will also talk about some of the new challenges in this area and what bank would have to do in order to meet those challenges. We'll have a very small section with respect to the IT requirements in this area in the recent future. So let's get our journey started. And we'll start with the definition of collateral. So collateral is something pledged as a security for repayment of a loan to be fortified in the event of a default. So if you go to the bank in order to take a home loan for you to buy a property, bank would lend out that loan to you only when you keep your home as a collateral. And why bank is keeping that home as a collateral? So that in case you are not paying your EMIs properly and bank realizes that there is a probability that you will default on your payments, they can cover their losses by selling that loan or selling that property in the market. This is shown in the diagrams that are listed below, where borrower takes cash from the lender and offers securities as collateral. At the end, when borrower pays back the cash and interest, the lender pays him back the collateralized securities. For this tutorial, what we'll do is that we will focus our attention on OTC derivatives transactions that are used in investment banking, major in the investment banking area, and we will see how collateral management is of key strategic importance to an investment bank. But before we do that, let's look at why do we need collateral. And the prime reason why we need collateral is in order to cover for our credit risk. The bank wants to cover from the situation that the institution or the party with which it was dealing may default, or the probability of its default may rise. There are two conditions: it may default, or the probability that it may default rises. So they may face a significant credit risk for any repayments that they have to get from this counterparty in future. And in order to mitigate that risk, they take collateral, so that if the counterparty or institution doesn't make the payment, they can go and sell the collateral in the market in order to recover for the losses. The credit risk exists whenever a firm has a relationship in which a counterparty has an obligation to make payment or deliveries in futures. So the word important is future, because this is something which is, or the payment has to be made in future, so there is an uncertainty associated with it, and in order to mitigate that uncertainty, you need collateral. Let's look at the graph that's listed below, and you'll see that during the crisis that happened, financial crisis that happened in 2007-2008, the credit risk suddenly increased, and so is the requirement for collateral. So I'll say that in 2008, 3.9 trillion was their overall collateral requirement across the world. Then in 2009 and 2010, it flattened out. We were recovering from losses. Economies were trying to come back from the shock that they achieved, that they got in 2007-2008. And the volume started picking up in 2011 and 2012. A quick comment on 2013, why there is a downward trend in with respect to the collateral. It's not because people things have become safe. It's because of the fact, in fact, it is because the things have become safe, but not because either the investors or the bankers or the borrowers have tried to do something. It's because regulators have come up with a new regulation where even the OTC derivatives now needs to be central counterparty cleared. So there will be a central counterparty where all these transactions, all these collaterals have to be reported and cleared in order to have a safe industry on OTC derivatives. We'll talk more about this in later session with respect to what is CCP, what are the challenges and what are the things it has introduced. But for now, the most important thing to understand is that when the credit riskiness arises, the requirement for collateral also rises. Now let's look at the advantages and disadvantages of collateral. The advantages of collateral are that it will reduce the credit risk. It will also help to save the capital for the bank, because in terms of asset liability management, your risk exposures would be low, so your risk-weighted assets would be low, and hence you would have to shell out less capital from your balance sheet in order to trade or in order to exist as a bank. And this is one of the Basel II requirements where you have to calculate the risk-weighted assets, and after you have calculated the risk-weighted assets, you keep aside an amount of the capital from your shareholders, that's the Tier 1 capital, as a regulation. The other thing is access to higher risky trades. So if the person or if an institution has deposited enough collateral with us, we can allow him to enter into a higher and risky trades. And in finance, having a risky trade is not wrong, because the complete finance is based on the model that your returns is going to be high when you take more risk. No one is going to compensate you for not taking the risk. And hence the fact that many of the institutions or hedge funds or your customers would want to take risk based on their risk appetite. But in order for you to secure your position and not get exposed to a lot of credit risk, you will take sufficient amount of collateral. It leads to more efficient trading between counterparties, because there can exist a sense of trust that the transactions would be, or the buy and the sell portion of the transactions would be completed successfully, and the default risk will not be there. Some STP transactions, more STP transactions without hassle of credit review and settlements. So since there is enough collateral, you can STP the transactions. You don't have to look at every transaction line by line and see whether it has the credit requirements that needs to qualify for this transaction. Disadvantages, obviously there's a false sense of security that you have kept a collateral and hence you should be allowed to do more and more trade. It's like this. So if you lock your house and you have a sense of security because that your house is locked in, no one will come into that house or no one will do a burglary into that house, then to a certain extent it's correct. But you cannot be fully complacent of the fact that there is a lock, so hence no one will be able to move in. So there is a collateral, but you should not use it as a false sense of security that it will cover all your credit risk. there may be a situation where your credit risk is not covered and you may have a domino effect for the collateral that you have collected. Collateral agreement is a contract, so there is a contract cost associated in going for a collateral agreement, where there may be legal procedures, there may be perfection risk in terms of perfecting a claim, there may be an enforcement risk in order to enforce a counterparty to pay you back your principal and other exposures. There may be review risk that may come at a periodic interval with respect to reviewing the collateral agreement. There may be recharacterization risk. So whatever you have deposited in the bank of whatever you have kept as a part of an agreement, I'll give XYZ collateral. The value of that collateral may have gone down, or that collateral may not be sufficient, so you may have to put in some other types of collateral. So there's a recharacterization risk that can occur. And then there's a priority risk with respect to in which priority the collaterals will be settled and whether you would get anything once the collateral is settled. Then there's a settlement risk that is involved. So since collateral take T plus 1 or T plus 2 days based on the liquidity, and it may take even longer, it may take up to 4 months if you have a property to be sold or anything like that. There is a big amount of settlement risk that is also involved. In fact, in 2007 financial crisis, banks were not able to get out of the property because the market had dried up and there was no buyer for that property in the market. In order to sell a house, it was taking somewhere between 14 to 24 months. Then there is, so you get exposed to a lot of settlement risk. Then there's a concentration risk with respect to you have put in a lot of a single type of assets on your balance sheet, and if there is a jitter for that asset class, then you may be severely impacted. Since more collateral is required, it can also reduce the trading activity. So trading activity increases because there is trust, and trading activity decreases because the people who are speculators are no more interested to come into the trading activity, because speculators generally have a credit crunch and they don't want to keep up all that collateral that is required for them in order to enter the transactions. Then there's the pricing risk and the model risk. The model against which you're calculating your collateral may be wrong, and there may be certain deficiencies in that model because that model may be history based or there may be a future event that no one has predicted, and your model risk is there. And obviously it's a little bit expensive, the entire process is a little bit expensive with respect to maintaining the contracts. Now let's look at what are the items that are eligible as collateral. So the items or the securities that are eligible as collateral should be liquid and marketable. When we say marketable, there should be a market that exists for that type of asset that you're keeping as a collateral. And it should be liquid. It means that it can be converted from that asset to cash very soon. So if you have a bond, it can be converted to cash very soon. But if you have a house, it cannot be converted to cash very soon because there may be a period. It is not a liquid market. There may not be a liquid market where there are so many buyers that as soon as you put your house on sale, someone comes to buy that house. Okay. It should be easy to settle. So as soon as you have entered the contract, there is a settlement period associated with it. So things should be easy to settle. Things that are easy to settle are either exchange traded or they have a large cap. They are large cap equities, or they are mortgage backed bonds, they are treasury bonds, they are AA corporate bonds. So these are easy to settle because there's a demand for them and there is a complete market in order to settle these instruments. They should be of high quality. The quality is defined by ratings that are given by Moody's or Standard & Poor's. So what you would like to have is bonds which are of highest quality, AAA bonds, and you can go all the way up till BAA bonds that are there. Junk bonds and emerging market bonds have lowest acceptability. Very few companies or very few banks would be accepting that. But since it's an OTC world, you can't say, you can't be very sure. So hence you can even keep more of those as well. Finally, it should be approved by the credit department, because credit department takes a look at lot many macro regulations that are there in the industry, and also a lot of competition based information. Hence the collateral that is to be used on your bank should be approved by the credit department. Finally, what is admissible collateral in OTC world as of now? This is generally what's there. So there's a lot of equities that can be taken as collateral. These equities have to be large cap, highly liquid, listed, and listed at major exchanges. There can be bonds, which are government bonds, corporate bonds, state bonds, structured products like MBS and ABS. So these can be taken as admissible collateral. Then there is cash. Cash is the most preferred thing because it's most liquid and it can be easily traded, and there's a market, there's always market for the cash. But within cash also there's a prioritization. So USD and Euro are the top ones which are accepted as cash. Then it is followed by GBP and JPY, Japanese Yen. Others form a very small segment. Then in terms of commodities, generally gold is there. Guarantees and LCs have also come as new form of collateral. And there are other metal commodities, but the percentage is very, very small. Let's look at the distribution for these types of collateral in 2013. So the very first picture, that's cash collateral breakdown currency wise. You would see that Euro and USD were the major cash currencies that were taken as collateral. GBP was 3%, JPY was also 3.1%, and others, all other currency, which would include the major currency as Swiss franc, was approximately 1.30%. Finally, in terms of bond, US bonds were highest kept as collateral. Then there were European bonds, then there were Japanese bonds, and there were bonds from United Kingdom, as well as finally there were other bonds across the world. The table that's there is says of what is the percentage of securities that are kept. So highest is corporate bonds, 27.60%. You can say why, because of the fact that the riskiness is less and there is a liquidity market for them as well. Followed by equities, followed by government agencies. Why government agency is less? Not because they are risky, but because of the fact that they don't give out so many government agencies bond or bonds that are there. Then one interesting fact why I didn't draw a pie chart for this is for the fact that metals and commodities, I wanted to show that metals and commodities, that includes your gold, is 0.1% of the collateral, and 0.1% on that pie chart would not be visible. And hence I just wanted to show that the major things are bonds and equities that are used across as a collateral. Cash is obviously the first choice because that's the highly liquid collateral that's there. Thank you. From next section onwards, that is collateral management part 2, we will cover how collateral management function is set up within the bank. And in the last lecture, we'll see future trends for collateral management. Thanks a lot.